maintained no matter where you go. We fill up from the back. But we're in good company. You know, so did the man that Jesus declared was justified. He sat at the back of the temple beating his breast for his guilt and shame. I am using the text from the New Revised Common Lectionary, or Year B, which is John 13, verses 21 through 32. I am a stickler for lectionary. I guess that's just the way us retired military folk are. We find a structure that works, we just stick with it. And if it's not broke, you can improve on it, but don't tear it down. Amen. Amen. John 13, I see other people coming, so if you notice, I'm going a little slower than usual. John 13, verses 21 through 32. After saying this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and declared, "Very truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me." The disciples looked at one another, uncertain of whom he was speaking. One of his disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, was reclined next to him. Simon Peter therefore motioned to him to ask Jesus of whom he was speaking. So while reclining next to Jesus, he asked him, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus answered, "It is the one to whom I give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish." So when he had dipped the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas, son of Simon Iscariot. After he received the piece of bread, Satan entered into him. Jesus said to him, "Do quickly what you are going to do." Mm-hmm. Now, no one at the table knew why he said this to him. Some thought that because Judas had a common purse, Jesus was telling him, "Buy what we need for the festival," mm-hmm. or that he should give something to the poor. Mm-hmm. So after receiving the piece of bread, he immediately went out, and it was night. When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once." I want to tag this pericope with the subject, post-resurrection power for pre-resurrection failure. Post-resurrection power for pre-resurrection failure.
Listen.
Father, I thank you for your word. Whenever I read it, it speaks to me in myriad ways. I pray that the words that you have allowed me to see in this text will speak to the hearts of these your people. Thank you for this blessed word today. May it empower and encourage us to keep on being true to your gospel. It is in Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Jesus is seated at the table with his disciples, breaking bread with them. And suddenly the Holy Spirit gives him a glimpse of what he will have to endure in the coming hours. Among this revelation, Jesus sees Judas, his treasurer, betray him. Mm-hmm. His closest ally, Peter, deny him. And then the other 11 desert him. Talking about a vision from God, Jesus certainly had a vision. These men are not strangers. They are close associates, his disciples. Men who supposedly have left all to follow Jesus. All ambitions, all worldly pursuits, all worldly desires for power and prestige. Men who have traveled with Jesus across the Palestinian valleys and the Judean hills. They have crossed the Sea of Galilee with him, even endured criticism of him, and have had intense debates regarding his theology. They know him, and yet they don't know him as well as they should. The fact is, it is in the hour of greatest adversity that they get a chance to discover that they are not who they think they are. They are not the courageous 12. They are more like the hateful 8. They are hot mess. They are pre-resurrection disciples in need of post-resurrection power to be effective witnesses of Jesus Christ. Amen. This revelation to Jesus by the Holy Spirit of his betrayal was most traumatic. It was Jesus who said he came to seek and to save them that were lost. But I have to wonder if originally he knew it would come by way of Judas, a man he chose to be in his inner circle. And when the Holy Spirit revealed it to Jesus, the Holy Spirit moved in such a way that it caused Jesus to reflect back on the words of King David in Psalms 41 and 9.
All right.
Yea, my own familiar friend, in whom I trusted, which did eat of my bread, hath lifted up his heel against me. I wonder if he was being prophetic, David, I mean, when he wrote those words, or if Absalom's betrayal hurt him just as much as Judas's betrayal tormented Jesus. But let's move on, it's lunchtime. We cannot linger here. Right. Consider the journey of the betrayal of Judas. A disagreement on method of revolution. A plan to usurp the authority of Jesus. The enactment of that plan, which included receiving the 30 pieces of silver from the priest. Then receiving the bread from Jesus, and finally the kiss in the Garden of Gethsemane. But let's go deeper. Judas betrays Jesus first in his heart. It is a spiritual betrayal, a walking around in conversation with the devil, being stirred to act on his worst inclinations. However, his thoughts are revealed to Jesus, and because of Christ's love for Judas, it becomes so traumatic an incident that it caused Jesus to groan with grief. You see, Judas does not betray Jesus until Judas is blessed by Jesus. It is only after he receives the bread that Satan enters Judas. That's another message all by itself. The Holy Spirit gives Jesus a vision of pre-resurrection failure, betrayal, denial, and abandonment by his closest disciples. It is at this point Jesus realizes that there are some tests, some things that we must go through where we have to travel the road alone. There is a cross that each of us must bear, and is a cross that at some points of the journey, others are excluded. Because only in solitude, only as an individual, can you experience the mercy, the grace, and the glory of God on that journey. It was torture. I know it was torture. But despite his tortured soul at this revelation from the Holy Spirit, Jesus knows what will happen post-resurrection. That's why the scripture says, but for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame.
He saw
not just pre-resurrection failure, but he saw post-resurrection victory.
Yes, he did.
He had good news.
Yes, he did.
God have mercy. He knows that there will be post-resurrection power granted that will empower at least 11 of the 12 he chose and others to continue his ministry in the earth. So because of that joy, because of that hope, Jesus embraces his destiny and submits to God's will for his life. Mm-hmm. And isn't that why we celebrate Holy Week? We assemble because we understand the blessing of post-resurrection. Yes, when pressure is applied, we may fail, but that's pre-resurrection. That's our earthly nature. But we have a new nature in Christ that rises up in us. We may be betrayed, we may be denied, and even abandoned. Even our loved ones may walk away from us, but in the hour of our greatest need, there is post-resurrection power. How many times have we resolutely proclaimed a stand for righteousness, justice, and equality, only to back down in the face of our opponents? How often have we made vows to God, only to see ourselves fail to fulfill our vows? This is the stuff of pre-resurrection, stuff we are called to overcome with post-resurrection. But as I close, isn't it good to know that there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein, and sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilt and shame? I'm so glad that God has given us a solution to our pre-resurrection blues. For I hear the Apostle Paul declared, when I would do good, evil is always present with me. Yeah. And then Paul asks and answers the question, who shall deliver us from this pre-resurrection blues? Who shall deliver us from the struggles with our natural carnal self when we're trying to live as a faithful steward to God through his Christ? Who can do it except Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior? Him writer, as he reflects on this and sees all that Christians endure and suffer, what can wipe away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. So I stop by here on this Wednesday of Holy Week to share with you that there is post-resurrection power coming from pre-resurrection failure. There is a day coming that we celebrate called Easter. And there is a day coming that we celebrate called Pentecost. And so if your inner circle breaks down, keep hope alive. If you find yourself a victim of betrayal, denial, or abandonment, remember that it was in a similar incident that Jesus said, now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. It is in that hour when your entire world is turned upside down that God will get some glory out of your life. Remember, you may not be able to dictate what happens to you,
that's right,
but you are responsible for the spin that you put upon it. Sometimes you may be left alone, ostracized, rejected, and abandoned, betrayal business indiscriminately. But you, if your perspective about life is in order, you can experience the glory of God in your life. Remember, beloved, God is not dependent on your friends or your associates to use you. God does not need you to get over 1,000 social media followers in order to make you a sponsor of the cross of Jesus Christ. Jesus saw his betrayal, denial, and abandonment as an opportunity for God to be glorified, and so should you. That is our message today. Beloved, no matter what you're going through, you sit in the seat and in the place and in the status where post-resurrection power is available to you. So I challenge you today to not let your pre-resurrection failures define you, but get up and get back in the race. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.